I have good news. You only have to sit through one more lesson and then you graduate. Welcome back. This is the final session of our project. This is Chrysler 46 RE class, part 2, lesson 7. In the last lesson, we took apart, cleaned, and reassembled several sections of the valve body. In this lesson, we'll finish putting it together and install it into the transmission. We'll also bolt on the pan, install new output and speed sensors, and finally reattach the selector and throttle pressure levers. Let's continue the valve body reassembly. Set the wood block under the upper valve body casting in order to stabilize it. Turn the transfer casting over and set it like so. If you are working on a 1996 and later model, replace the small 3/16 of an inch diameter check ball, which you set aside earlier, into the oval pocket located here. Turn the lower valve body separator plate over and set it like so. Turn the lower valve body over and set it onto the assembly. Install 13 2 1/8 inch long screws which fasten the castings together. The thin steel tube retainer goes here. Note that if the model you are working on uses the later 2-screw filter, an additional 14th screw should be installed into this hole. Torque the screws to 35 inch pounds or 4 newton meters. turn the valve body onto its side. Insert the boost valve tube. Turn the valve body back over. Bend the tabs up in order to fasten the tube. Insert the pressure regulator valve into its bore. Insert the switch valve into its bore. This long spool section goes in last. Set the long pressure regulator spring onto the pressure regulator valve in, like so. Set the adjustment screw into the bracket. Set the switch spring onto the post next to it. Maneuver the bracket into position and install a half-inch long screw through the middle hole of the bracket. Make sure that the switch spring is seated onto the end of the valve. Check to make sure that the pressure regulator spring is seated correctly between the adjustment screw and the valve. Finally, check that the throttle valve lever cam is between the valve end and the head of the adjustment bolt. Insert and start, but not tighten, a 2 1/8 inch long screw through the bracket here. Turn the valve body over. Install a 1/2 inch long screw through the bracket here, finger tight. torque the middle screw first to 35 inch pounds or 4 Newton meters. Tighten the other two screws the same way. Installation of the solenoid and wiring harness assembly is next. Let's get it from the Deluxe Super Kit. Here it is. Fasten it to the valve body with 3 3/4 inch long screws. Torque them to the same specs as the other screws. Set the valve body aside. This is the governor body assembly. We need to disassemble and clean it, as well as install a new governor pressure solenoid and governor pressure sensor onto it. My assembly has already been cleaned, so I'll simply go through the process. Set this gasket aside. Set these two bolts aside. Slide the stamped steel bracket off. Pull the old governor pressure solenoid out. Use the pick to pry out a clip which fastens the governor pressure sensor. Pull the sensor out. Get the new components from the kit. Here's the new governor pressure solenoid. This is the new governor pressure sensor. Begin reassembly by installing the sensor. Our demonstration model uses this 4-pin oval connector type. A new sensor should have an O-ring in place here. Make sure that it is present. Push the sensor into the body. Replace the clip. Turn the body over. Add fluid to the two O-rings on the governor pressure solenoid and press it into its bore in the body. Slide the retainer into place. Never reuse the old body to casting gasket. Here's the new one from the kit. Place it into position and set the governor body onto the transfer casting. Install the screws and torque them to 35 inch pounds or 4 Newton meters. Connect the wiring harness. Arrange the harness like so and turn the valve body over. Attach the case connector to the casting with a special screw which has the long shoulder. After tightening the screw, the connector should move freely from side to side. This concludes the reassembly of the valve body. We'll attach the filter and parking rod later. You can now set the parts which we removed earlier back onto the bench. In order to make valve body installation as easy as possible, I like to reposition the transmission onto its side. We need to install the accumulator and spring assembly into this bore here. Get them from the bench. You can replace the old scarf cut Teflon seals with new ones from the kit if you want to. I like to reuse the old ones simply because these seals do not wear or deteriorate. Put fluid onto them and place the piston into its bore. Set the spring on top of it. The valve body can be installed now by two different methods, and I want to spend a little time explaining both. Method number one is a little less complicated, but does require the removal of the entire overdrive section. In order to demonstrate, I'll get the valve body with the parking rod attached to it. As I said, the first method installs the valve body with the parking rod attached into position on the selector lever. To do this, remove the clip from the pivot on the parking rod assembly. Push the pivot point through the selector lever and install the E-clip. Installing the valve body into the transmission with the parking rod attached is almost impossible while the overdrive housing is attached to the main case. Even though the valve body can and was removed this way during teardown, it can't be reinstalled this way easily. The problem is, you cannot feed the rod through the back of the case and into the parking mechanism at the correct angle. You will have to remove the 7 bolts which attach the overdrive housing to the main case and slide the assembly off of the intermediate shaft. This way, the rod will protrude through the hole in the back of the case, allowing you to easily set the valve body into place. You can then align the rod with the opening to the parking mechanism and easily reattach the overdrive assembly. There is another way. Method number two does not require you to remove the overdrive housing. To demonstrate, I must once again detach the parking rod from the selector lever. Set the E-clip aside. Take only the parking rod to the transmission. An alternative method is to install the rod through the back of the case and into the parking mechanism by itself first, and then attach the rod to the valve body. Wear gloves as you do this. These edges are very sharp and can cut your fingers and hands. Feed the rod through the back of the case and into the overdrive housing until it comes into contact with the parking hammer. Apply pressure to push the rod with your left hand as you turn the output shaft with your right hand. Eventually, the end of the rod will go past the parking hammer. Now you can attach the rod to the valve body selector lever. Get the valve body and small E-clip. Apply transgel or fluid to the selector shaft and to the O-rings on the case connector. Lubricate the case connector bore too. Set the valve body like so and maneuver the pivot pin on the parking rod into the hole on the selector lever. Push it in until the groove for the E-clip is visible. At this point, we should install the E-clip, but there is a very good chance that it would fall down into the case where it would be very difficult to retrieve. There is a way to prevent this by using a piece of wire. I attach the end of a length of very small gauge copper wire to the E-clip with a small loop. My source of this wire is from a section of Cat 5 Ethernet cable. As I said before, dropping this clip into the transmission could be a disaster. The wire gives you some control over it as you attempt to install it. Snap it into place. Remove the wire. Carefully align the selector shaft and case connector with the openings in the case. Push it into position part of the way and stop. Make sure that the selector shaft is going through the seal without rolling the lip up. If it does, back the valve body out and try again. The shaft should come through the seal as this one has. Push the valve body completely into position. 10 bolts of 3 different lengths fasten it to the case. Let's get them from the small parts box and sort them out. Arrange the 10 bolts into 3 groups according to length. The 3 shortest ones are 1 1/4 inch long. The next group of 3 are 1 7/8 inch long. The 4 longest bolts are 2 3/8 inch long. We'll install the 4 longest ones first. The 4 longest bolts go here, 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 and here. Install them finger tight. Get the 3 bolts, which are 1 7/8 inch long. Install them here, here, and here. the last three bolts to install are 1 1/4 inch long. These three shortest bolts go here, here, and here. The torque specification for these bolts is 100 inch pounds or 11 newton meters. Installation of the filter is next. Get the long screws which attach the filter to the valve body. Depending upon which type filter your model requires, you will need 3 for a felt type or 2 for the black plastic and steel type. Attach the filter. Torque the screws to 35 inch pounds or 4 newton meters. Set the pan gasket into place. Never use any additional sealers with this gasket. The gasket is the seal. If the model you are working on came with a black colored rubber reusable type, reinstall it. It is superior to a quart type. Get the pan. Make sure that the magnet is present and position in this area of the pan. Set it onto the case. Get the 14 pan bolts. Do not get the bolt which is used to fasten the speed sensor retainer. This is a unique bolt which is slightly longer with a smaller diameter washer. Once again, this bolt goes with the retainer. torque the pan bolts to 13 foot pounds, 150 inch pounds, or 18 newton meters. Reposition the transmission so that the pan is underneath it. Install the output sensor. It is item number D92436. The torque specification is 20 foot-pounds or 27 newton meters. I simply tighten it lightly with a ratchet. Get the vehicle speed sensor assembly as well as the retainer and bolt from the small box. The center line of the driven gear shaft is offset in the housing. This allows the housing to accommodate a variety of different diameter gears, which are selected based upon the final drive ratio in the differential. The wishbone shaped retainer and notches in the housing allow it to be installed in three different positions. Note the number on the gear. I see 32. This is the tooth count. Now select one of the three ranges embossed on the side of the housing this number will fall within. This range is for 26 to 31 teeth. This range is for 39 to 45 teeth. The last range is for 32 to 38 teeth and corresponds to the 32 teeth on the drive gear in this transmission. Install the housing with this group of characters facing downward. Remove the old O-ring and replace it with the one from the overhaul package. Lubricate the opening in the overdrive housing. Make sure that the range numbers which correspond to the number on the gear are facing downward and push the assembly in. Install the retainer and bolt. Tighten to 100 inch pounds or 11 newton meters. get the neutral safety and backup light switch. Install it into the case. Get the last two parts in the box, the selector shaft lever and throttle pressure lever. Set the lever onto the selector shaft like so. Tighten the pinch bolt. Install the throttle pressure lever with the round hole onto the shaft first. Tighten the bolt. If the dipstick tube type in your vehicle requires a boot type seal, get the new one from the kit and insert it dry into the hole. Place a small amount of fluid or transgel onto the inside in order for the tube to slide in easily. The transmission is now fully assembled, but before I conclude this class and let you go, I want to discuss a major component that goes with it, the torque converter. Our like new transmission would not be complete without a high quality remanufactured torque converter. For many reasons, I do not recommend reusing an old one. For example, it's not unusual to find an unacceptable step worn into the hub on the old one where it rides on the pump bushing. And remember, even if the hub appears okay, there may be internal problems such as a bad thrust bearing or a worn out lockup clutch lining. Torque converters are sealed and cannot be inspected internally. Take my advice, get a new replacement. Let's install it into the transmission. There is a little mystery about correctly installing a torque converter. Your goal is to work the converter hub into the pump far enough for the lugs on the inner pump rotor to go into these slots. A loose rule of thumb to follow on only 46RH and 46RE models is the converter is completely installed when the flex plate to converter bolt pads are 3/4 of an inch below flush with the edge of the case. Once again, this rule only applies to gasoline engine models and not for torque converters used with the Cummins diesel engine, which are much larger and actually protrude beyond the edge of the case. Here's another great tip. The converter should turn freely against the flex plate after the transmission has been bolted to the engine. In other words, you should be able to move the torque converter with your fingertips in order to align the pads with the bolt holes in the flex plate. If the converter is jammed up against the flex plate and it will not turn, the converter is not installed all the way. Stop. Remove the transmission and work the torque converter all of the way in. That's it for this class. I've always enjoyed working on this transmission, and I hope you will too. Once again, I'm James Williams, and it's been my pleasure to share with you what I know about this amazing machine. Thanks for watching.